partake on a regular basis of the All Night Vigil on the eve of the liturgy on Sunday. I ask that question for a number of reasons, one of which is because, of course, the liturgy is not a self-contained service. It is, and it is not. It is not in that we begin our preparations for liturgy, and specifically for receiving the Holy Mysteries the night before. Hopefully we have come and listened to the lessons that are taught in the Old Testament readings, if there are the three that are normally accounted for. And hopefully if we are going to receive the Holy Mysteries, we come and confess our sins so that we are reconciled to the Church. All of this should take place most properly on Saturday evening. Now, we are in a large and thriving and growing parish, which is truly a blessing. And we have a blessing to hear confessions on Sunday morning. But dear brothers and sisters, please let us always remember that this is a condescension that is offered to us. It is something that, strictly speaking, should not take place. And large parishes often do this because they simply cannot hear all of the confessions otherwise. But the norm is that once we hear those words, blessed is the kingdom, all of us should be focused on the work of the people, that is, the divine liturgy. But dear brothers and sisters, I would like to return to today's feast in particular. We know that on the seventh Sunday of Pascha, it is the custom of the Church to commemorate the 318 fathers of the First Ecumenical Council. And I ask you that leading question because on this feast, in ways that are not necessarily as apparent on other feasts, the connection between the Old Testament readings that we hear at Vespers and the theme of the Sunday are particularly clear. If you think back, we had three Old Testament readings yesterday. The first was from Genesis, and the next two were from Deuteronomy. In the first, we hear of Abraham taking 318 of his trained servants and going in pursuit of his nephew Lot, who had been captured and taken prisoner. And it was Abram, who had not been renamed Abraham by God yet, who pursued and overtook the captors and recaptured his nephew. If we look at the two readings from Deuteronomy, we see that the first establishes the line of judges, taken from among the wise and knowledgeable and compassionate of the tribes of Israel. And we know again, as I began at the beginning by talking about the fact that there are certain condescensions that are taken because of the size and activity of this parish, so God took condescension as well upon his people Israel. And he appointed judges for them. Because one person could not hear all of the cases, all of the grievances that were brought by the people. The third and final of those Old Testament readings speaks of the obligations that the Old Testament faithful of the tribe of Israel had in terms of worshiping their God and keeping faithful the things that they had given them. Now, if we look back at the Old Testament, we remember, brothers and sisters, that we had first the giving of the priesthood. God established the Levitical priesthood to maintain the worship and to maintain sacrifice. And we know that the priests gradually fell away, as did the people. And so next, God sent prophets. And of course, we know what happened to the prophets. We hear about this throughout the church here. So next, God sent judges. And the judges were meant to make sure that there was good order maintained within the tribe. And finally, God sent kings. And under all of these systems of judgment, under these systems of rulership, the people fell away from God. We know this. The Old Testament is replete with stories of how God had to periodically re-cleanse his people because the people, either their leaders or the people themselves, fell away. So there's our Old Testament thing. But if we look at the New Testament, the epistle reading from the book of Acts also ties very closely to the series of Old Testament readings, in that it also exhorts the elders of the church to hold fast to that which they have been taught and to safeguard their sheep from attacks both from within and from without. And of course, today's reading from the Gospel of St. John the theologian establishes the divinity of God. And this brings us to the feast directly that we celebrate today. The number attributed to the First Ecumenical Council historically has been 318, which is our link back to Genesis. That's a fairly direct link. But if we look as well at what was accomplished in that first council and what it was convened to talk about, we see that it speaks very directly back to the Gospel from St. John. Christ's assertion of his own divinity, his assertion of his being with the Father from the very beginning, is in and of itself a refutation of the heresy of Arius, who of course taught that God was not creator but creature, that he could not have existed from eternity because he had to have been created at some point. And even though he was greater than common humanity, he was still less than God. It was this heresy that the First Council was brought to combat. And of course, they settled other various administrative things within the church. But the big teaching that came out of this council was that God is and exists in terms of both the Father and the Son. The Trinity, as it was comprised of the Holy Spirit as well, was of course taken on later. But this first council very thoroughly established the Godhead of Christ. And in this we see made perfect in the life of the church that which was spoken of in the scripture that we heard last night and this morning. These 318 fathers suffered for their faith. Many of them came blind and maimed and halt of the lives of the fathers' sake. They suffered, they witnessed to their faith, and they came and they proclaimed the truth. They took up that responsibility that was laid out by St. Paul, saying to safeguard the flock from wolves that arise both without and within. But dear brothers and sisters, lest we think that the story ends there, that we live in a church, that we participate in the life of a church that is dictated to us by the teachings of the bishops. The councils also teach us that while it is the right and the responsibility of the bishops to proclaim the truth, we hear this every liturgy, when we pray for our ruling hierarchy in particular, that he rightly divide the word of the truth for us and for the entirety of the church. But nonetheless, that is only part of the story, because it is also our responsibility to receive that word, to incorporate that word into our lives, to be transformed by it, and to uphold it through the living out of the faith. We see throughout the history of the church that when teaching has proven true, the people adopt it, because it is our common responsibility to uphold the faith. And when a teaching is incorporated formally into the life of the church, it becomes part of the fabric that is the body of Christ. But we also have examples of those who have promulgated false teachings. And in those cases, the faithful have risen up and declared their fidelity to the true faith. This is the responsibility that all of us are called to, dear brothers and sisters. Not only our hierarchs, not only our priests and clergy, but all of the faithful are called upon to safeguard the faith. That is the deposit which has been given to us today in this feast that we celebrate. May we not be passive sheep. May we not think that it is our responsibility only to come to church and to open our mouths and be fed like baby birds. That is not what we are called to, dear brothers and sisters. We are called upon to actively participate in the faith, to actively and vigorously uphold the faith, so that we too might be called champions of Christ at the judgment. This is the calling of all of us, whether martyrs or not. We are all called to be saints, and not just in the next life, but to begin that path to sainthood in this life. Remember, St. Paul called saints not only those who had gone on before, but those who were still in the flesh. To be a saint means to be set apart. We are called upon to be set apart, not in a way that brings attention to the fact that we're special, but in a way that is meant to declare our fidelity first and foremost to Christ. Dear brothers and sisters, may we hear and truly imbibe the lesson that was given to us in today's feast. May we truly seek to receive the teachings of the Church through the tradition which encompasses Scripture and the dictates of the councils and all the fabric of our worship and our prayer life and praxis that we have been given. May we receive all of this, but may it bear fruit. May it become something that is for us not passively received, but that becomes actively transformational in our lives. May we become witnesses, as the fathers of the First Ecumenical Council were, that we also may rightly stand before Christ and say that we have loved him enough to maintain that which he has given us. Amen. Blessing of the Lord be upon you through his grace and love for mankind.